Van, on election night in 2016, you said Trump's election was in part a white lash. Is that now what we're seeing? Are we seeing what a white lash really means?
Well, I was talking about that part of the Trump base. You know, not every Trump voter has those views, but that part of his base that is not offended or holding their nose, but actually is enthusiastic about these racially inflammatory things that he says and he does. Part of I think what is important to keep in mind is that not only were those comments racist, they're also just inaccurate. When you have 30% of Americans have college degrees, 43% of African immigrants have college degrees, 10% of white Americans have advanced degrees, 25% of Nigerian Americans have advanced degrees. So he's just completely dealing with a stereotype from his childhood that has no relationship or little relationship with what's going on right now. And I think that what I'm proud of is that the media just called it like it is. If he had said, listen, I only want skills-based people. I only want engineers. If they're from Nigeria, if they're from Norway, I only want engineers. That's not racist. But when you say the whole country is not welcome, that is the definition textbook of racism. And I'm glad that the media just called him on that. He wasn't saying, I want skills-based people, no matter what color. He says, I want people from this country, no matter Norway, no matter how unqualified, and I don't want anybody from these countries, no matter how qualified. That's the definition of racism.
What I saw on television, especially on CNN and MSNBC, were anchors and reporters standing up for American values, saying, I'm an immigrant, or my family came from so-and-so country. They were almost kind of asserting leadership because the president doesn't assert leadership. They were trying to stand up for what makes America, America. That's what I saw. Is that what you saw, Van?
That is what I saw, and I was actually proud to be a part of the profession. I mean, here's the thing. Obviously, it's not the job of the news media to lead political causes and political crusades, but the fundamental core value and ethic of the United States is this idea that it doesn't matter who you are, where you came from, you can make it here. You don't have to be rich to be worthy. You don't even have to have a college degree. I was talking about college degrees. You don't even have to have a college degree to be worthy. And that, and had you not let quote unquote shithole people come here, you wouldn't have the Kennedy family. You wouldn't have so many great families. And so that's who we are. And to have the President of the United States back away from that and then do it in such an offensive and vulgar and low way, I think it's objectively the case that what he said was racist. And I'm glad that the media held that line.
It's notable that it leaked out, and we're going to talk about the role of leaks in a moment. But David, what about the idea that if anchors on this channel or other channels stand up for American values, talk about the Statue of Liberty, et cetera, that comes across to some viewers as if the press is the opposition to President Trump?
Well, and Trump, and you know what, Brian, Trump will play that. I mean, Trump and his people will play that, play that as if he's being attacked. That's the price we pay for doing good, down the middle, honest journalism when we have someone like this in the White House. And by the way, usually when you do that, it costs you money. In our case, the people who are doing the best kind of solid, responsible, down the middle journalism, the New York Times, the Washington Post, are doing pretty well in terms of digital sales. And I think CNN's ratings are pretty good. So that we're not paying a price. We're doing God's work. We're righteous, and we're not paying a price for it when we have someone like this in the White House. And Brian, one other thing I want to say, just beyond American values, standing up for American values, I thought CNN and MSNBC especially did a great job of when they told this story about that comment, of showing a pattern of racist comments from this president. They put it in context, and they had like Jake Tapper's discussion with him about the judge of Mexican heritage who he said could not rule on his case because he was Mexican American. And Jake Tapper said, is this not the very definition of racism, just as Van did? And we have that continuum now. So I think some people who the first time he did something like this said, oh, no, he's not a racist. That's just people being something. Now we have several incidents of this, and you see the pattern. And it's very hard, I think, for any reasonable person in this country to deny what he is. And
funny,
journalism is doing that, yes.
Some critics say 2 years ago this pattern was already obvious. Why did the press take so long to pay close attention to it? On the other side, you have a lot of people defending him, saying just calling him racist is an exaggeration, an overreaction. Van, what about the language here? Look, I've got an 8-month-old daughter at home now. I think about what she's hearing when the television's on. Did we excessively use the actual curse word in the coverage?
You know, I was very reluctant to use the term at first. Because, you know, again, you do have that hesitation, and it has very little to do with journalistic standards. It just has to do with being a decent person and not wanting to use offense. Yeah, decency.
Right.
You know, just don't want to use language that might offend somebody who's turned on and watching. They might be shocked, but at the same time, it's shocking that these words are being used in the White House about whole countries and whole continents. That's much more shocking than some pundit, repeating it. And so I do think it's important that we not sanitize it too much. We have the opportunity to do so on cable TV to really tell it like it is. And, I think we did the right thing. Honestly,
and I think there's still some situations where people are more comfortable using a curse word than saying something is racist. I mean, you look at the broadcast networks, there was barely any use of the curse word, but there was even less talk about racism.
Yeah, I think that's interesting. One thing I do want to say since we're talking about this is, I think that what the other thing journalists have to do, though, is to go even deeper and to point out a couple of things. It's not just that African countries actually are all basket cases and all the African immigrants are just here pulling America down. We just shouldn't use the word shithole. It's not about making the stereotypes a little bit more palatable. It's about pointing out that African immigrants are coming here and in neighborhoods from Oakland to the Bronx, bringing down the crime rate, bringing up the learning rate, bringing up the entrepreneurship and making America great. Same with Haitians and same with El Salvadorans. In other words, this idea that, well, maybe they really are shithole places, you just shouldn't say it, and maybe the people who are coming here are not worthy to be here, that also needs to be challenged based on the facts. The educational attainment for African immigrants exceeds the educational attainment for European immigrants. Nobody was aware of that. So if you want to have the conversation about what's going to make America great again, let's have it. One last point I have to make. If you close the door to immigration as severely as Trump wants to, shut it down, you know who gets hurt the most? Trump's older, white, retiring voters who are going to then be living in a country where we'll be like Japan. We don't have enough young people in America. We're going to have a bunch of older people in America. We need immigration to keep the economy going so that their retirements can be secure. So it's not just racist, it's not just counterfactually, it's also politically stupid to keep out the younger part of the world that wants to come here and make our economy work. This is just dumb and wrong and racist across the board. Let's have that conversation, not only have the conversation about the vulgarism. The vulgarism is just the additional harm to the country.
Van, thanks for being here. And David, please stick around. One more note about this. We're seeing new denials just this morning from some of the Republican lawmakers that were with Trump when this meeting happened. I just have one thing to say about that. If there was a news report that said that I personally had insulted an entire continent by using a racist remark, I would deny it at the top of my lungs from every possible medium within about 10 minutes. The fact that the White House did not deny this right away, that other news outlets confirmed it right away, and then later the president half-heartedly denied it, it kind of speaks for itself. Think about it. If you at home said something like this, how would you react?